Good evening and welcome on behalf of the Kellogg Institute for International Studies. I'm the director. And it's a delight to see so many people here for our Guillermo O'Donnell lecture. The Kellogg Institute established the Guillermo O'Donnell Memorial Lecture Series in 2013 in honor of the Institute's founding academic director, Guillermo O'Donnell. O'Donnell was a superb institutional leader as well as an accomplished scholar. At the time of his passing in 2011, he was among the most cited social scientists in the world. He was also a leading public intellectual in the promotion of democracy and of human development, particularly in his native Argentina and elsewhere in Latin America. O'Donnell's work has been described as normative, innovative, rigorous, global, and relevant. Relevant not only for social scientists, but also to policymakers and to citizens. The annual lecture established in his name and funded by the Johnson Family Endowment for Excellence is designed to honor and carry forward the enduring legacy of O'Donnell's scholarship by focusing attention on work that furthers its core themes, the twin aspirations of fostering political participation and enhancing human welfare. Speakers for the series are chosen from among distinguished scholars, public intellectuals, and policymakers who have made major contributions to understanding or promoting democracy and human development around the world. Former Chilean President Ricardo Lagos delivered the inaugural O'Donnell Lecture at the Latin American Studies Association International Congress in Chicago in May of 2014. We are now delighted to bring the O'Donnell Memorial Lecture home to Notre Dame. We're pleased to be able to welcome Gabriela Hipólito O'Donnell back to her alma mater to represent the entire O'Donnell family at this event. And most of all, it's my honor to introduce to you tonight the 2015 O'Donnell Lecturer. Like Guillermo O'Donnell himself, the renowned economist Daron Acemoglu is known for his creativity in bringing together issues of democracy and human development in innovative and important ways. The Elizabeth and James Killian Professor of Economics at MIT, Acemoglu's major scholarly contributions in political economy and in macro and microeconomics have made him one of the most cited economists in the world. His far-reaching research addresses why some countries are rich and others poor, with a particular focus on the impact of political and economic institutions on the development around the world. In 2005, Acemoglu was the recipient of the prestigious John Bates Clark Medal, awarded for significant achievement by an American economist under 40, often seen as a precursor to the Nobel Prize. He holds a PhD from the London School of Economics and is the extraordinarily prolific author of peer-reviewed articles, working papers, and books. Two of his critically acclaimed books he co-authored, and I think soon a third, from what I understand, with Harvard political scientist James Robinson, The Economic Origins of Dictatorship and Democracy, and Why Nations Fail, The Origins of Power, Prosperity, and Poverty. These have been bestsellers extending a new understanding of issues of democracy and development far beyond merely the academic world. He's the recipient of dozens of prizes, awards, fellowships, and honorary degrees from institutions in the United States, in his native Turkey, and elsewhere around the world. As the chair here of our economics department, Keo Hesburgh, Professor of Economics Bill Evans has noted quite simply, Acemoglu is one of the most influential economists of our generation. Please join me in welcoming him to Notre Dame.
Thank you very much, Paolo. Thank you for this very nice introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here to deliver the Guillermo O'Donnell Lecture, and O'Donnell's work, of course, has influenced everybody who works and has worked on democracy. And in fact, also what I'm going to talk about today, the capacity and the nature of the state. This is a joint work with James Robinson, as Paolo noted. In fact, this is sort of the beginning of a new book project and sort of culmination of a number of articles and ongoing work. But it's in fact the first time that I'm giving this talk. When I sent the slides to Jim, he said he immediately corrected me. And he said, I'm no longer at Harvard, because I had MIT and Harvard. He's actually at Chicago, so he's your neighbor. So that was my mistake. But he's not in Chicago yet. He's still at Harvard. But he still wants me to put Chicago here, so I don't know. So we live in a hugely connected, globalized, unified world. But despite that, there are great differences in prosperity. So this map here, colors in different shades, different levels of income per capita. The dark greens are the rich places, the dark reds are the very poor places, and if you look at this, there are huge gaps, or about 50-fold differences between the richest and the poorest places in terms of GDP per capita. So, of course, for many of us, it's even hard to imagine how anybody could survive with the average income one-tenth of that in the United States. But, you know, many, many, many people do much less than that, who live with much less than that. But, in fact, this is only one facet of a broader set of differences in the conditions of people around the world. If you look at various measures that we associate both with quality of life and also with the ability of the state, if it exists, to provide services and security, the gaps are incredibly large also. So for instance, if you look at child mortality, you see a similar huge gap with the difference between the highest and the lowest being of the order of about 80. If you look at security of life, for example, homicides, it's a mind-boggling difference between the highest places, some of them in Central America, for example, and the lowest places, for example, in Scandinavia. And these are also associated, they're not perfectly correlated, but they are generally associated with the GDP per capita differences that I have indicated. They are also very strongly associated with something else, which is various measures of quality of government. So for instance, here I'm using data from a recent index that people at the University of Göttingen have developed, which is measures different aspects of how well the governments function in terms of impartiality, in terms of delivering the services that they're supposed to deliver, where they're supposed to deliver, without political influence, without bribes or kickbacks playing a role. Again, there's a huge difference between countries. Once more, it's not perfectly correlated between income per capita or even some of the other measures that I saw. For instance, you know, here, Russia is the big offender in terms of not having a big, much of an impartial bureaucracy, but generally you see the sort of the extent of huge differences that exist. Same thing in terms of professionalism, how bureaucrats are recruited meritocratically or through political influence, and so on. In many of these, for instance, sub-Saharan Africa, Central America, parts of Central Asia don't do very well, and those are exactly the places that, on the basis of qualitative evidence or casual empiricism, you would have picked as where the state is not functioning very well, or the quality of life, both because of general poverty, but also through a variety of other aspects of how the public services are organized, is very much below what people are used to in Western Europe or more prosperous parts of the world. Now, I'm going to start with an extremely quick overview of some of the ideas that James and I developed in our book, Why Nations Fail. I'm going to do that both because I want to draw on some of these ideas in sort of developing the ones that I want to put more emphasis on today, but also because I think, at least for this thought, I felt that it would be useful for me to give you a not only sort of the my current thinking, but how it sort of evolved to sort of come to the place that it is. So in Why Nations Fail, as Paolo very nicely summarized, we try to explain the differences in income per capita that we observe around us. And we focused very much on this income per capita. We mentioned public services and so on and so forth, but mostly as an input. But in terms of economic and political institutions, in particular, we distinguish as the sort of the two polar extremes as extractive and inclusive economic institutions. Extractive economic institutions are those associated with insecure property rights, entry barriers, lack of any sort of enforcement of law or rule of law, and generally a non-level playing field, meaning that some people are greatly advantaged at the expense of the rest, and often these people happen to be, of course, those who benefit economically or otherwise from the prevailing economic arrangements. So I'm going to refer to those as the elite. You know, that's a very overused term, but you know, let me stick with it in any case. Inclusive economic institutions are the sort of the opposite. They provide secure property rights. They have an impartial legal system that supports the contracts and enforces laws in an impartial manner. So we sort of relate to some of the figures that I showed you at the beginning. And it has the sort of the right sort of provision of things like education or some of the public services that I've mentioned, like access to infrastructure, access to healthcare, and so on and so forth, that create a generally a level playing field. And the main argument in the book was that inclusive economic institutions are the ones that are most conducive to sustained economic growth because they do two things. First of all, they create a fairly broad distribution of opportunity in society. The level playing field here is very important. If you have a tilted playing field, then you're going to have opportunities being only open to a very few people in society, and that's not going to mobilize the talents and the skills of the people in society as effectively. And second, they also create incentives for these people to develop their talent in the best possible way and make investments and, most importantly, undertake innovations and improve the technological capability of the economy also. But as soon as you start thinking about economic institutions, you realize that you can't just stop there. So take a quintessential example of extractive economic institutions. It will be a system like slavery. For instance, take the island of Barbados in the 17th century. You have about 80% of the island's population are chattel slaves. They don't have any freedoms. In fact, they don't even have the freedom to sort of sell their labor or decide what occupation to work on. They are sort of coerced to work on whatever their masters orders them under the threat of physical punishment or even death. And you have, as a result of this system based on slavery, most of the slaves working in sugar plantations, you have a highly unequal economy where, you know, Barbados was one of the richest countries in the world in terms of income per capita, but of course the slaves lived at below subsistence level. Many of them actually died before the age of 35 because the living conditions were so harsh and their living standards were so low. So how do you support an extractive set of economic institutions like this? Well, the answer is you need to have the right political institutions. So Barbados, for example, had a political system that empowered the slave owners, in fact, the small group of slave owners that were the major landholders, plantation owners and on the island. It also gave them legal power. So not only were the laws designed by these people, but also the top judges on the island were all part of that small elite. And it very importantly concentrated military power in their hands, because if you actually look at the history of Barbados, you see that there are frequent slave revolts, and the military power is very important in actually putting those slave revolts down and making sure that many more of them don't occur. Well, the top commanders of the island came all from all the same families, and they very much had a unified set of objectives in trying to maintain the economic system as it was constructed. So, motivated by that, we sort of talked about inclusive and extractive economic political institutions. Inclusive political institutions generally, not always, but generally supporting inclusive economic institutions, so there's some sort of a synergistic relationship there, and extractive political institutions supporting extractive economic institutions and vice versa. And this sort of little diagram here is meant to summarize that. You know, if you are in the off diagonals here, it's going to be somewhat unstable. You may stay there for a while, but there are going to be forces that push you either in the inclusive or the extractive direction. But most importantly, for my talk today, I want to emphasize that inclusive political institutions were not just what I let me sort of go back to the extractive political institutions. Extractive political institutions weren't just what I described in terms of the Barbados example. They weren't just the concentration of political power, oppression possibilities in the hands of a few people, and non-responsive governments, non-accountable governments. Those were important elements, and we defined those with the sort of concept of pluralism. So we refer to lack of pluralism or presence of pluralism, meaning a broad distribution of political power and broad-based participation, together with the right sort of institutional prerequisites for the political process to be able to check whoever was delegated to hold that power, be it the politician or other office holders. But it was also what we sort of argued, political centralization. So you needed some degree of political power to be centralized in an institution like the state, to have the barbarian monopoly of legitimate violence over a territory, and the ability of the state to regulate economic activity, to provide public goods, to introduce taxes as necessary, and just provide the right stability for economic relationships to flourish. And to illustrate that, we, for example, use the Somali example, where you have a fairly pluralistic distribution of political power going back to, you know, pre-colonial tribal institutions, but it's a very dysfunctional society because this political centralization is largely missing in Somali society. And then one final sort of element that I want to sort of emphasize from there is that, you know, the picture that I'm painting here is one where, you know, inclusive economic institutions undergirded by inclusive political institutions are going to be good for generating economic growth, or at least we argued sustained economic growth. So meaning, and I'll come back to this a little bit, bursts of economic growth can also happen under extractive economic institutions, under extractive political institutions, but sustained economic growth, one that's based on technological change and goes on for several decades, you know, is much more likely under inclusive economic institutions. But if that's the case, why is it that, you know, why is it that every society doesn't end up with inclusive economic institutions? A, why is it that every leader not choose inclusive economic institutions? And why is it that every society, even if its leaders are not choosing inclusive economic institutions, force them to do so? And the arguments that we sort of emphasize there is, A, the leaders are often not going to have the incentives because they may not be the ones who gain economically. So it might be good for society to get rid of monopolies, but that won't benefit the monopoly rents, and it won't benefit the people who are benefiting from the monopoly rents. And if the political leaders are among those, then they will not have any great incentives to do so. But secondly, and perhaps even more importantly, there was also a political argument for it. The leaders may not just be economic losers, meaning that they won't be the ones who economically gain from the introduction of inclusive economic and political institutions, but they may also be political losers in the sense that their political power may get destabilized because their political power often is situated in the context of an existing set of economic and political relations, and any reform of these is going to create some element of eroding that political power. So in particular, we sort of refer to this as fear of political creative destruction. So in the sense that, you know, there is the process that Schumpeter described, which sort of plays some role in what I've sort of summarized so far, that new technologies replace old technologies. Innovation comes with the sort of reallocation of economic benefits. There is also a political creative destruction, that new institutions come with the redistribution of political power. And of course, those who are currently politically powerful are often going to be afraid of that redistribution of political power, or they're going to be afraid of political creative destruction. So what's sort of making only a small appearance here as part of that either part of, well, you need the a little bit of state capacity in order to provide that level playing field, and perhaps a little bit as part of that political centralization, you know, you need the state to play a role. So you see that states is present in the story, but it's very much sort of in the secondary role. But if you actually look at many specific historical contexts and specific case studies, what seems to matter greatly is also the capacity of the state to be able to perform a variety of actions. These range from the monopoly of violence that I have already emphasized in the context of political centralization. Does the state actually control violence within a certain territory? Or do you have the state together with gangs who are able to do whatever they want? Is the state capable of taxing economic activity? If you look at taxes, as you can see here, they vary greatly. In fact, if you look at direct taxes, income taxes, they vary even more. Many countries are still less than 1% of GDP is raised in taxes, in direct taxes. So why? Well, part of it is a political choice, but part of it is that just many states are just not able to keep records of or force their citizens to pay the taxes. Is the state capable of actually providing public goods? In many parts of Africa, but I will also argue in parts of Latin America, you have states that are essentially absent in large swathes of their territory. So in Africa, you'll have states that look modern. In the capital, they have, you know, ministers and governments, but, you know, 70% of the country is outside their control. You also have great variety, as the maps that I showed at the beginning show, in the ability of the bureaucracy to do things that's related to this impartiality and professionality. So some bureaucracies are going to be very capable and are going to be able to keep track of things, implement policies that are legislated. Some other bureaucracies are not going to be able to do that. You can pass any legislation you want, but it actually is not going to get implemented. So I'm not going to talk about the evidence to a great extent, but there's now mounting evidence, both micro and macro, meaning both at the level of cross-country correlations, but also more sort of well-constructed, somewhat more convincing evidence comparing municipalities or regions, showing that the state capacity is A, correlated with economic development, and B, to the extent that we can ascertain causality, is actually a factor that hinders or contributes to economic development. So here I'm just showing you one picture, which is, I think, quite striking. If you look at the correlation between GDP per capita and taxes, this measure of the capacity of the state to actually raise taxes, it's hugely correlated. At the bottom here, you have countries, a lot of them in Africa and Central America, and at the top you have, you know, Western Europe and the United States. So, you know, some people argue, and there might be some point to that, that, you know, taxes discourage economic activity. There's probably some of that, but what is overwhelmingly important in understanding the cross-country correlation is that it's the rich countries that are able to raise the taxes for whatever reason. So once you sort of start thinking about the capacity of the state, an obvious question is, who wouldn't want state capacity? Even if you're the most kleptocratic dictator, one might think you should want state capacity. You want the capacity to control violence, to keep record of things so that you can better steal it. Why not? So if that's the case, state capacity is just a social engineering problem. Everybody wants it, and then some people can engineer it, and some people may not be able to do so for a variety of reasons. But what I'm going to argue is that the reality is much more nuanced, that the reason why there is so much variation in state capacity is because the extent of state capacity is determined by political and political economic factors. In particular, I'm going to argue that many states, though they appear to have some of the trappings of the states, modern states, are actually stunted, meaning that they really are devoid of either some or all of the dimensions of state capacity that I have described. Either they are unable to provide public goods or tax or regulate economic activity, or they are unable to have an effective bureaucracy that can implement policies, or they are unable to even control violence in their territories. In many cases, all of the above. And the main sort of argument I want to develop, which I'm going to illustrate with some historical examples next, is in this figure. So what I have on the horizontal axis here is pluralism, the same thing that I defined earlier on, which is the distribution of political power in society, how equally distributed it is, and how much power the society has, for example, to resist some of the demands of the state. So you could also call this strength of civil society, although the definition of civil society does vary so much across people that I didn't want to use that term. On the vertical axis, you have the strength of the state. So high strength means high capacity, and low strength means low capacity. So what I'm going to argue is that there are essentially three regions here, or three basins of attraction. If you are in this middle area, which I'm going to call region two, inclusive state building, you're going to have a dynamic political development path where pluralism and strength of the state are going to co-evolve and are going to jointly increase. If you are in the bottom part, which I've called region one, you're going to have what we've called states stunted from the bottom. Meaning that society is going to stunt the states and is not going to allow states to become powerful. And if you are in the region three, you're going to have the strength of the state higher, but even that, I'm going to argue, generally doesn't guarantee highly capable states. So often you're going to have what we call paper leviathans here, that look like leviathans because the state is so strong relative to some aspects of society, but it's still devoid of several important aspects of state capacity, as I've described it as being important for economic development. Let me start talking about region one. So to illustrate the region one, I want to go back to a stateless society, which was analyzed by a husband-wife team of anthropologists in the 1940s and 50s, Bohannons. It's the Tiv land, or a tribe called the Tiv in southeastern Nigeria. It's in this area here. And it's a very backward place in many ways. But what's interesting about the TIV is that, first of all, it's one of the stateless societies on which we know quite a bit because of the this anthropological work. And it has several clues which, you know, seem to be similar to other stateless societies, but in this case we have much more information. And in particular, what's very interesting is the role that various social norms, often couched in religious terms or witchcraft terms, not much difference for the TIV between the two, have played in political life. So there are many episodes in which, like in 39, there were big social upheavals. And these are often caused by various religious cults. And one of the things that seems to be the main driver of these religious cults is protection or fighting against witches, or embatsav, which I'm going to describe. Tsav in the TIV language means power, particularly power over others. Interestingly, the TIV don't distinguish good power from bad power too much. So in particular, tsav is any sort of power that an individual has. If you become very rich or a powerful politician, that's tsav. But if you actually engage in witchcraft and start eating human flesh or drink blood, that also gives you tsav. And the people who belong to an organization that is very powerful are called embatsav. In fact, embatsav is exactly powerful people, but also a group of witches organized for bad, nefarious purposes, to eat human flesh, for example. And essentially, what these many religious cults and the social norms that have actually existed in the society for a very long time have tried to do is to isolate people who are embatsav, which generally means people who are powerful, and limit their political power. So in this particular instance, for example, the big deal was that the British were trying to impose indirect rule through the chiefs that they appointed. And the witchcraft allegations turned against these indirectly appointed chiefs, and they were essentially stopped from being able to rule the TIV land. So what's going on here is actually a very illustrative example of a more general phenomenon. What the TIV do, which seems to be quite common in many stateless societies, is that they have social norms that very strongly make the society turn against anybody who seems to be accumulating or who has accumulated political or economic power. So these witchcraft allegations and a variety of other social practices essentially discourage people from concentrating power in their hands, and as such, nipped in the bud any attempt for forming anything that looked like a proto-state, because political power could not be concentrated in the hands of a family or a person, let alone an organization that would be powerful enough to regulate economic activity, tax, or make legal decisions that are fully binding. So what you are seeing here is a society that is extremely afraid, almost paranoid, but for good reason, of anybody who is powerful. And this paranoia implies that we are essentially in a situation where this, there is sort of power of society and broad distribution of political power. After all, they have already weeded out anybody who could be very powerful, and that is replicating itself, making the state essentially not emerge, and anybody who could be a upstart for doing something like this not being able to do so. Now, you might think that this is just a curious example from a stateless society, but there are several modern examples of this. One interesting one is modern Lebanon, where it is not individual power concentration, it is really power concentration in the hands of different ethnic groups that has been very strongly fought against by society. So Lebanon is a patchwork of many different ethnic groups, as many of you know, Sunnis, Shiites, Druze, Maronites, and Orthodox Christians being the leading ones. It's like a map of this, it would look like this, the ethnic map of. And since end of the World War II, essentially a lot of the institutions of the country have been organized so as to prevent any one of these groups to dominate the country and its political system. So as a result, you have a parliament that generally is dysfunctional, a system where power is extremely distributed across different ethnic groups. The president comes from one ethnic group, speaker of the parliament comes from another ethnic group, prime minister comes from another ethnic group. As a result, public services, even laws and economic budgets are not passed or implemented, as illustrated recently by the sort of the refuse sort of scandals in Lebanon. And very interestingly, it's Lebanon doesn't even hold censuses. It hasn't held a census since 1932, because a new census would describe, would reveal a new distribution of population and would force a redistribution of political power, so it's better not to actually codify that. So, and one other thing, this picture, of course the state doesn't have anything approaching the monopoly of violence. It's the different militia groups, the most famous and powerful one being the Hezbollah, but you know, every ethnic group has its own that actually control means of violence in Lebanon. So this sort of gives you a sense that it's not always favored by society to have the building of the state. The main reason why the building of the state is problematic for the society is that you can't trust whoever is going to become politically powerful. After all, many powerful politicians or families or economic groups have become tyrants, especially when the institutional foundations and the perhaps the social norms to control them have been absent. So as a result, in situations where those institutional foundations are not present, one strategy is to prevent that concentration of political power, and as a result, state building never gets off the ground. The other region, region 3, if you recall that was this one, is where the state is very powerful and the pluralism, both institutional and otherwise, is not present to check it. Well, in that case, what do you get? In that case, what you end up with is just various different shades of authoritarian state building, ranging from Ottoman Empire, Turkey, Rwanda, Pakistan, and so on. You have aspects of state building going on, but it's highly authoritarian in the sense that pluralism does not accompany it. And in fact, even if there is some degree of pluralism on the ground, it gets stamped out quite quickly. But importantly, this doesn't always guarantee the emergence of a high-capacity state either. So we sort of discuss several examples of this in our work, but one of them is Colombia, which is particularly interesting because if you actually look at the center of the country, Bogota, and some of its major cities, it looks extremely modern, it has a well-functioning bureaucracy, it has courts that are very very professional. But on the other hand, 30 to 40% of the country until recently was under the control of paramilitary groups that was and that were entirely sort of free to do whatever they wanted, which often meant kidnapping, displacing people, stealing stuff. And some other part of the country was under the control of the guerrillas, left-wing guerrillas. And, you know, since time is short, let me not go into the history very much, but a lot of this came to light when one of the paramilitary leaders who was supposed to demobilize sort of had his computer fall into the hands of authorities, and then a whole sort of slew of stuff got revealed. And then after that, there was many more sort of cases brought against some of these supposedly demobilizing guerrillas. One of them is this chap, for example, which in his deposition said, you know, 35% of the Congress was elected in areas where there were states of self-defense groups. This is how they called themselves. And those states, we were the ones collecting taxes, we delivered justice, and we had the military and the territorial control of the region, and all of the people who wanted to go into politics had to come to deal with the political representatives we had there. And this is not just one statement. There's a lot of qualitative evidence, and both from depositions and from other places, that sort of supports that. And if you look at a map of Colombia, all the blue areas are the places where there was high levels of paramilitary activity. So what's going on here is that somehow, even though the state looks very modern, and it is either incapable, but I'm going to argue much more likely, unwilling to extend its monopoly of violence and its ability to penetrate society beyond a small confine of the country. And some might think that this is just a lack of modernization. As the economy modernizes, as society modernizes, all of these problems are going to sort of get resolved. So, for example, the famous influential political scientist Martin Seymour Lipset sort of articulated the modernization hypothesis that economic growth will bring democracy and lots of other good things, and you could put, you know, some things like state capacity and monopoly of violence perhaps among those good things. But as also sort of questioned very strongly by Guillermo O'Donnell, the modernization hypothesis doesn't seem to be sort of the whole truth. In fact, some of the work that I did with James Robinson, Pierre Yared, and Simon Johnson argued that it doesn't even hold very strongly in the data. So here in this figure, what you have is you have change in log GDP per capita in 5-year intervals, and then here change in measures of democracy, you have no relationship whatsoever. So countries that become richer don't show any greater tendency to become more democratic. So I think on the basis of this and other things, what we are seeing here is not just lack of modernization or a process that is itself going to sort itself out. So I think to get a better perspective on this, let me now go to region 2, which is the one in the middle where I argued pluralism and state strength co-evolved. And to do that, let me actually talk about yet another historical example. Now it's a cooler one about classical Greece. So there is a lot of scholarship, both recent and ancient, on classical Greece. We actually know quite a lot of things about ancient Greece. But what's sort of very interesting that doesn't often get emphasized, but it is stressed quite a bit in recent work by scholars such as Ian Morris and Josh Ober, is that actually the golden period of classical Greece, where both economic prosperity and population boomed, was very much the period in which there was the emergence of something that looked, by the standards of the time, very inclusive economic and political institutions. In the Athens case, which is where a lot of these things originated, in Athens and Attica, this sort of started with Solon, who was one of the very famous politicians, who was actually swept to power by some sort of popular support. And what he tried to do is he tried to build, essentially, what we would describe both as pluralistic economic political institutions and also actually improve the state capacity in some directions. So, for example, he made the in-serving of Athenian citizens illegal. He established freedom of movement, redistribution of land. He wanted to implement, but it's actually unclear how much of this did get implemented. But most importantly, perhaps for the purposes of what I'm emphasizing here, is that he also made the entire political structure much more quasi-democratic. So introduced an assembly, which was very powerful. It actually had, even though the different sort of people of different incomes were allowed to serve only in some parts, essentially the assembly itself was accountable to juries and the approval of the entire Athenian population, and also to prevent, and here you're already seeing the sort of a paranoia, just like in the TIV, to prevent anybody, especially to people who were very powerful economically, to be influential. He introduced a system where members of this assembly would be chosen by lot, and individuals could only serve for 1 year. So, which essentially made sure that almost all of the population of Athens at some point would serve in this assembly. Athens was not a very big place. Now, Solon's reforms did not fully stick, but and there was some attempts to centralize political power in the hands of some powerful generals. But then Cleisthenes was swept to power as a popular revolt because people, already sort of suspicious of centralization of political power. Again, you see the sort of the parallels to the TIV. Once they saw these powerful politicians, especially those suspected of having links with Sparta, they revolted and then brought Cleisthenes to power. So Cleisthenes sort of strengthened and further expanded Solon's reforms, and then this system of ruling by lot was actually implemented. But very important thing is that Solon had a hubris law, which again it's unclear how much of it was implemented, but was put on the books, which made behavior aimed at humiliation and intimidation against any resident of Athens illegal. Cleisthenes actually strengthened that and turned it into a law called ostracism law. So the word ostracism actually comes from that. So essentially what this was is that every year the assembly would vote whether there was a case for ostracism. And if that was the case, for example, 50% said yes, then each citizen would write a name of somebody to be ostracized on the name on a fragment of broken pottery called ostracon. That's why the name ostracism comes from. And whoever got the most votes from these pieces of broken pottery would be ostracized. And essentially, this was a disciplining device against any powerful person who was accumulating power. And essentially, if you were ostracized, you had to leave Athens for 10 years. And it wasn't used very often. Only 15 people were ostracized during the 180 years of the golden period of Greece. But it seems to have been a fairly effective threat that people were very much afraid of aspiring to be a tyrant. One person who failed that is this famous general called Themistocles, who was the hero of the war against Persia. So in any other country, he would be the biggest hero in the world, because he single-handedly argued for a big fleet, and that big fleet played a crucial role in defeating the Persians. And but instead of being crowned, or at least held on a pedestal, he was actually ostracized because the Athenians thought that he was getting too big for his britches, and he was trying to accumulate more power than he should have. So you see this sort of same paranoia, but again for good reason, because once these institutions left their sort of power, lost their power after the Peloponnesian Wars, actually tyranny came back to Greece. So, and this actually happens to be exactly the period in which you have the huge Greek boom. So this is, you see the consumption and population. This is the period in which you have these laws being applied. So, but what's going on here is that you have an example of this ability of the civil society and the pluralistic social norms being able, and some institutions, being able to check the power of the state and powerful politicians. And what this enables actually during this period, you also see that the state starts doing more in terms of providing certain public services. So this is sort of part of what I'm trying to capture in that region two. So what you have in region two is that the paranoia, that is what I described for the TIV, is still present. But that paranoia can be turned into a more positive force. In particular, what you have is that you should still be afraid of the power of the state and the power of the upstart politicians or anybody who's going to be able to sit atop of a large bureaucratic machine or the monopoly of violence, but you may be able to give them a long leash if you have the right institutions and the right social norms to be able to control them. And where does that coevolution come from? Well, that coevolution comes from because if, in fact, the whole system is going to evolve, if the state's going to become stronger, you need to strengthen the control mechanisms of the state and the politicians in order for that to happen. And I think the best case of the illustration of that is actually the state building in England. So let me talk about this one final historical episode, and then after that I'll give a few more conceptual points and I'll conclude. You know, the period after the War of Roses, Henry VII, Henry VIII, and after that the Tudor, one more Tudor, Elizabeth I, is generally viewed as a sort of a despotic period in English history. And in some sense, it was. What Henry VII, Henry VIII, and Elizabeth tried to do was actually centralize political power. The barons had their own armies, their liveried retainers, there were a huge number of exemptions from all sorts of laws and taxes. Land was entirely out of the control of the state, and all of these things were sort of started to be changed. But also, very interestingly, this was the period in which society, you see, becomes much more powerful and highly participatory. So during this period, you have a whole host of local organizations that are emerging. So here is one, when Swallowfield, Wiltshire, in 1596, a group of local residents come together and they pass 26 resolutions. And if you look at these resolutions, essentially they are a combination of local governance, we're going to get together, we're going to decide things, and implementation of law and order. You know, breaking the law, stealing things, drunken behavior, disorderly behavior, those are bad. A lot of this is coming together for a variety of reasons, but mostly because, A, it is these local communities that are asked to do any sort of local services and local law enforcement. There's no professional bureaucracy. And second, they are actually being empowered because the entire structure of society is changing. So, as this example, it's also strengthened because you see a whole sort of meritocratic structure of government officials is not the right word, but people, the parish officers, developing in order to implement a more complex set of laws is emerging during this period. So, and if you look at this, many of the sort of the public goods that we sort of associate with this era, including poor laws, is actually emerging in this era. Many of the things that we associate with the early modern Britain and that sort of last into the 19th century, such as poor laws, is actually sort of emerging from the bottom up during this period. And in fact, again, just to show you some correlations, even today, if you look at it, it is the places that have better, at least on paper, ability to control their politicians, for example, as measured by polity's score of constraint on the executive, that are the ones that are able to raise high taxes. Once again, naively, one might think, oh, you know, central government is going to raise more taxes when it's out of control. Well, it's the opposite. It's the central governments that are tightly controlled, at least on paper, that are either able or willing to raise more taxes. So what's going on here, and let me sort of, since time is sort of running short, let me just sort of get to the bottom line of what I sort of want to emphasize on region two, is that it is that in having a pluralistic distribution of political power, and the institutional foundations of that distribution, society feels better able to control and better able to trust state authority and state power. So, continuing the trend that started with the Tudor government, you see, for example, that the big jump in taxes in England happens right after the Glorious Revolution. Now again, naively, one might be surprised by this. After all, wasn't the Glorious Revolution fought against the Stuart monarchs because they wanted to control everything and they wanted to borrow and tax and build their army, etc. So perhaps after the Glorious Revolution, when the sort of parliament takes control and the merchants and the gentry now are politically powerful, they'll do the exact opposite of what James II and Charles II wanted to do. Well, it turns out they do exactly that much stronger. And what's going on is that now Parliament feels it can control the state budget. So once it can control it, it wants it to be larger because it can control it for its own good. So this is what I've called elsewhere consensually strong states. It's not a strong state that is imposing its will on the people, but it is a strong state which comes out of the consent of society, because the society thinks that it has the ability to keep the state accountable, and therefore it's willing to trust it and give it a long leash. But once you sort of push this argument further, you see that it will also imply that state building will also encourage pluralism. Why? Well, if I'm really keen on building the state, one of the things that's going to hold me back is that society doesn't trust me. So if I want to make sure that I can build a state without the resistance of society, without being accused of being a witch or ostracized, in the case of the Tiv or the ancient Greece, I should give better controls to society so that they can be sure that I won't run out of control. And for that reason, again, going back to the Tudor revolution in government, what these supposed despots did, Henry VII and especially Henry VIII, was that they also strengthened parliament. So they introduced the notion, especially Thomas Cromwell's notion, of king in parliament. King would rule through parliament. And that the idea was that by strengthening the parliament, you're actually giving a guarantee to these people that you're not just going to use your increased power now to totally expropriate them or go against their wishes. So now, so far I haven't talked about the economic foundations, wonder what economic conditions it is. Let me not spend too much time on that, but of course it sort of is the things that you could guess, you know, a more equal distribution of economic and military power, for example, in the Athenian case, and in the British case, in the English case, a more equal distribution of economic power, the end of feudal servile relations, are all contributing factors because they actually reduce the rents from holding power and they increase the ability of society to control the politically powerful actors. So, for example, in the Greek case, it is no surprise, in some sense, that the golden age of political inclusivity and therefore economic growth came not during the time when bronze was the key metal, because bronze was very scarce and it meant that only a very, very, very small group of aristocratic elites could control the means of violence. Whereas the Iron Age, when iron became extremely cheap and the sort of the hoplites, the sort of citizen soldiers of Athens became, you know, the sort of the dominant force, now everybody is armed and it's much easier to sort of say, no, we don't like you being a tyrant and you should leave because, you know, there's a much more balanced relationship. So let me sort of conclude. I wanted to talk about rights, but I have already exceeded my time. So just to conclude, I think the main idea, which I've tried to sort of both give you some conceptual foundations and illustrate it with some examples, is that I think the way that one might think, and several social scientists have, about state building, either as a social engineering problem, every state can be built, it's just a question of making the right investments and getting the right advice, or thinking of it as state building is necessarily a top-down process. You can only build a state by having a very powerful military presence or some other centralized authority that's going to impose all of these things on society, I think is largely incorrect. Instead, capable state building that actually does bring the capacity to do all of the things that we talked about at the beginning, control violence, bring public services, have the ability to have a capable bureaucracy to implement things. All of these things develop more naturally when we have a balanced process of state building going hand in hand with the society's institutional and non-institutional means of controlling power. Institutional means through legislative, judicial processes, non-institutional ones, just like the ostracism or the witchcraft in the TIV, through social norms, through which society feels comfortable that it can withstand the power, the increased power of the state. And if this is the case, I think it does have interesting implications for policy. One of the things that, you know, James and I totally refrained from in Why Nations Fail was to give any sort of policy advice, because I think institutions are important both politically and economically, but how do you change them? But here I think some interesting policy perspectives start emerging, because if state capacity is so important and encouraging state building is central, you know, how do you do it? And I think the perspective that's sort of emerging here is that both at the national and the local level, state building that happens at the expense of civil society, such as in Afghanistan, Somalia, or Turkey, for example, is going to work badly. Either it's going to create a backlash, or it's going to lead to the sort of paper leviathans that are strong in some respects and not in others that are more important. Instead, working with traditional social norms and expanding them and strengthening civil society at the same time as building state and state strength might be a much more constructive way of going. Let me stop there and I'll take some questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Daron. So there is some time for questions, I think, as here, so if you have a question, please wait until the microphone comes around to you.
Yes, Guillermo.
Thanks. My name is Guillermo Trejo from the Political Science Department at Kellogg Institute, and thank you for such an insightful, interesting lecture. It's quite revolutionary to hear this alternative model of state building that doesn't emphasize so much the top-down, the elite-driven, the war-driven, but you really close in social norms and civil society, and it's a bottom-up. But let me try to challenge you a little bit on the question of civil society, because you yourself said, I cannot define civil society because there's so many definitions of civil society. And in the end, when you say my bottom line, my takeaway message is civil society. This is a theory of developing, of state building from below. What's below? What's civil society? What's what do we mean by, so maybe it would be great if you could just go in that direction.
Yes, very good. Thank you. And you know, I avoided using civil society throughout the talk, but then I put it on the last slide. So, lapse of judgment. I think in the context of the Athenian and the English cases, which I have read a little bit, the way that, you know, successful institution and state building worked was that they started from some existing social norms and local organizations, in both cases, I think, non-institutionalized organizations, and they strengthened them and modified them. So that's essentially the loose definition of what I was trying to communicate in this slide. Now, that will differ from society to society, and by its nature, in many societies, it will not be much to write home about. In Afghanistan, we know that the strategy of building a state in Kabul did not work when it sort of trampled on these things. You know, working with them may have been very unattractive for other reasons, but essentially, that might be the only solution in some cases. And but, you know, is that civil society? In what says it's civil society? That's part of the reason why I don't, you know, want to use that term too much. But if I, pluralism, I think at least the way we define it has more of this institutional distribution of political power and doesn't sort of get into these issues of traditional rights, traditional roles, etc. And that's why it may be too narrow. So.
Yes, please. Hi, Erin McDonald from Sociology and the Kellogg Institute. I thought the way you talked about the two elements working together was really interesting and compelling, and I wondered if maybe I could lend you through my question some time to talk a little bit about the timing and how that works. When you first started talking about ancient Athens, there was this compelling idea that there was a huge kind of policy revolution, and that the way I understood it when you were talking was that it sparked this flourishing. But then when you put the graph up, it seems like there's like 500 years of uptick in consumption and population before we get to that period of the policy revolution.
Right.
And so is the idea that without that policy revolution, the counterfactual is a crash, or that it would head towards a different society? Just trying to make sense of, because when I first started looking at it, I was trying to find like, oh, where's the inflection point? That must be the policy, but it's really right in the middle.
So you have the Bronze Age centralized state, the tyranny of the Bronze Age collapsing, and then you have growth already picking up thereafter, after that sort of part of that trough. So during that period, you have sort of about 200 years of sort of mixed government or mixed society. You have the Dark Ages, or the so-called Dark Ages, which is, you know, that collapse already happens, but already in the Dark Ages, despite the fact that it's called dark, you know, the evidence we have, a lot of it from Homer and people like that, so you know, it might be somewhat colored, but is that, you know, you have very different set of social norms and greater participation both in economic and political activity already starting. And then you have an interruption, so to speak, of that during that 100 year between Solon and Cleisthenes. But, you know, already some sort of social changes are taking place during that period. But, you know, for example, as I was trying to say, we don't know how much of Solon's reforms were actually implemented or not. So. Yes, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation. I'm Samuel. I'm from the law school, a JC student. So my question relates to the first slides of your presentation, and more specifically, focuses on the theory that you put forward in your book, Why Nations Fail. So in your book, you say that the reason, one theory that explains why there is a difference between nations is some nations have managed to build inclusive political and economic institutions, and others have failed to do that. My question is, I don't think that totally explains the difference, because I ask myself, and why do some societies create those institutions, and why are some societies not able to create those institutions? And again, my other question is, why is there this trend of regionalization, in the sense that why are some regions not able to create, like continents like Africa and Southern America, not able to create institutions, and others in the North Hemisphere are able to create those institutions? Does your theory explain that? And the other question, and this is the last one, is what do you think would be the role of the state, like in 100 years from now? Do you think it would be as important as it is today? Thank you.
So, wide-ranging set of questions. So, let me sort of try to give some very brief answers. I mean, obviously, I didn't talk much about the details of the thesis of Why Nations Fail, and of course, it doesn't sort of in social science, I don't think it's possible to explain everything or even most things. It's just a set of forces and tendencies. But what we sort of emphasize is, there are very good reasons why most societies don't build inclusive institutions, and that's because they start with extractive institutions, and once you start with extractive institutions, it's very difficult to make the transition. So a lot of the book is devoted to explain why extractive institutions stick and why they create a particular configuration of political power and economic relations such that even if they become destabilized, what follows them is often another set of extractive institutions. So the question is, what is it about some societies that sort of makes them break the cycle, and what we sort of stress there in the book is that it's a combination of factors. Some of them are random factors, and some of them are related to economic and political developments that have taken place over many centuries. So many of those are geographically concentrated. So, for instance, the fact that you have no centralized authority that emerged in the European sort of continent after the Roman Empire. That's something that affects the entire European set of states, and the fact that, for instance, the access to the Atlantic and the associated trade, which affected many of the countries in Europe, that's again sort of a correlated factor. So I think there are a variety of reasons why many of the economic and political forces that we emphasize in the book are geographically correlated. And as a result of that, we argue in the book that there is actually nothing inherently different about, say, Peru or Bolivia or Algeria that makes them, condemned to be poor or middle to poor income level 2,000 years ago or 3,000 years ago, but it was the particular distribution of political events and the institutional trajectories of these places that sort of led to that outcome. So in that same vein, coming back to your last question, what will the state be in 100 years' time? I think 100 years' time is probably pretty close to where we are today, that we probably can say that there will be a lot of persistence. But if you were to say 300 years' time, I think there will be a lot of factors that we cannot sort of think about and sort of the small random shocks that interact with the underlying conditions, as we have sort of tried to argue in Why Nations Fail, that might kind of totally change the face of state-society relations and also how that is distributed over the across the world. But having said that, you know, I don't believe that, you know, some of the most optimistic sort of thesis that are articulated that with information technology or whatever, the state is going to entirely change its character and so on and so forth. You know, I think if you sort of have the ideas that I've tried to sort of briefly talk about here, you know, a lot of that is about the political economy of the state, and just because, you know, you have a better technology is not entirely going to change that. But as in the case of what I've described, in the case of sort of the Iron Age changing the distribution of power within the Greek society, you can have that new technologies may destabilize that sort of things, but so far I'm not sure that we're seeing that.
Thank you for the very interesting talk. I'm Ferdinand Lubizahum from the Political Science Department. I have a question about the graph where you showed the regions. And if I understand right, there are some arrows in that graph that show paths of evolution. Let's call it like that. And if I understood the arrows right as well, they all seem to me that they start at the bottom left of your graph. Yeah. And they all move in different directions. So all states or all societies kind of start at low levels of both pluralism and state development. My question is about the Hobbesian state of nature. I'm not completely sure I would characterize the Hobbesian state of nature as a situation of low pluralism. The Hobbesian state of nature being a situation where you actually have an atomistic society that is actually the peak of pluralism for some senses. So actually the Hobbesian state of nature would be very low on the y-axis, but very, very high on the x-axis. So, and if that is true, and we depart from this idea that all society or all start as a Hobbesian state, they would follow very different paths. And my confusion, I think, comes from the fact that it's not clear to me what you're calling pluralism. As sometimes it seems that it's organized civil society being strong, as sometimes it seems to me that it's the widespread or the unconcentrated means of coercion. So I'm not completely sure how I understand and where would you place the Hobbesian state of nature in this graph.
I think that's a very good question. I'm not a great fan of the notion of a natural state, but you know, I agree with you that, you know, if you go back in time, it's not clear where, you know, stateless societies in the Americas or in Africa or in Asia, you know, would they be here? Would they be here? You know, I certainly did not imply that they all start from the origin. And if you see, you know, look at these sort of, in fact, what distinguishes region one is that in the region one, they start with much higher level of pluralism or strength of civil society, if you want to use that term, than state strength. So that's why countries like the TIV, polities like the TIV are unable to build state strength. And that's, I think, is quite a common thing. So that's what, you know, this was sort of meant to communicate. But I think the other question you're asking is, what is the exact definition of pluralism? Is the TIV or the Somali are at the highest level of pluralism? And I think not, but again, here, you know, I need to be much more nuanced, and that's not the details that I wanted to enter, because, you know, what they have is some set of social norms that distribute political power equally and create a sort of an environment in which it's just very difficult for one person or one family to become totally dominant. But none of this is institutionalized. So they don't have the judicial or legislative or other institutional prerequisite that solidify these things. And it's actually quite important that they don't, because if those pluralistic institutions were stronger, it might make it possible to permit sometimes even somewhat more state building. So it's the fact that they have the, you know, again, for lack of a better term for now, let me call it pluralism. They have it right now, but it's not fully institutionalized. That's why it's so fragile, and that's why it could easily fall prey to a warlord or an upstart in some sense. Yes, please?
I think it's going to be the last question.
Okay. I think that gentleman was earlier. Sorry.
Hi. So I have a question, and it's exactly regarding this kind of phase diagram. So as I understand it, if you're in region 3 and you're like in your path towards the limiting of strength of state, you need like this kind of shock to get to region 2 and just like drive the cell path towards super development. And that's kind of a nice romantic story, you know, because the shock from region 3 to region 2 actually tells you, you know, like you have this strong state and you need to be more inclusive and let people be more plural and stuff. But I think that the shock required from region 1 to region 2 is kind of, I don't know, frightening, and I don't really know if there's like kind of a continuum, because in there it says, you know, you have a society that is too plural, so you need a state that must grasp more power, and that kind of power is only built, you know, like as you said, it's a monopoly of violence, you know. So I cannot picture which kind of shock can allow you to acquire more power, like you, to centralize more the monopoly of violence without immediately jumping to a region 3
kind. I think that's a very good question, and I think that's a real concern that many cases I think this picture is extremely simplifying, and many important details are missing, and some of them, you know, we have not even fully conceptualized. But, you know, you're absolutely right that in many cases you have stateless societies with egalitarian norms and certain certain customs that, you know, prevent any sort of power accumulation, and then you have a shock, and then suddenly you go to tyranny or some strong accumulation of political and economic wealth in the hands of a narrow group. So, but I think the reason why the picture is a little bit more complicated, at least a little bit more complicated than what this one suggests, is that, you know, pluralism here can come, for example, from political power being in the hands of local elites. So if you look at if you think of the 15th century England, you know, before the War of Roses and all of those events, you know, it's certainly not a pluralistic society by any stretch of imagination. If you by pluralism you mean equal distribution of political power within the population, but it is a society where you have the state being extremely weak relative to local interests. So you have the aristocrats and the barons and the local landholders being extremely strong, and the king is just not much of a position to impose much on these interests. And then the sort of the big sort of dislocation that happens in society during the War of Roses creates a window of opportunity where these local aristocrats and power holders are weakened, and that's where the Henry VII and Henry VIII's sort of power concentration begins. So that would be one way of interpreting shifting from region 1 to region 2. But yeah, obviously that requires distinguishing between pluralism where it's everybody's powerful versus pluralism versus some local elites are powerful against some central elites.
Good. I'm sorry to have to cut off the conversation, because I know that there are many more questions, and in part because they're going to give us such wonderful things to reflect on. I hope the conversations, though, will continue out in the atrium during the reception that immediately follows this. But before we adjourn to there, please thank our guests for being here.
Thank you. Thank you.